I demand part, but if you guys want to believe it, terrific. I had, in fact, just to offset that, I had a novel come out a few years ago, and it was my first. And a friend of mine went to a Barnes & Noble to look it up. And he found it there on the front table, between sandwiched between a Superman anthology and a book by Martha Stewart. And so my friend brings out his phone to take a picture of my book, and the guy comes from behind the counter and says, excuse me, what are you doing? My friend says, oh, I'm taking a picture of my friend's book. And the guy from behind the counter says, you've got to be kidding me. You're friends with Martha Stewart? So I say this by way of saying that, I'm very much a journalistic foot soldier, a guy with a pen and a not very often recognized byline. We've had really good fortune the last 2 years and gratified to win a Pulitzer Prize, but nevertheless, a far cry from Martha Stewart, and it's nice to be honored for our work and to be asked to speak, and you have made me feel a little bit more like Martha Stewart for the day. So from mild comedy, very, very mild, to tragedy. How's that for a segue? It's all downhill from here. I'm going to begin by telling you guys about the grisly death of two rocket scientists, Keith Odell and Jim Ferraro. Now, on its face, the story I'm going to begin with has nothing to do with your brain or the impact of heavy technology on your brain or what I've committed to tell you about today, but I'm hoping by the end of the talk to prove otherwise to you. And by the way, since I'm going for about 35 minutes, and that's a long time to keep your attention in this fractured attention era, I'll break this down a little bit into chapters. We'll call this first chapter about the two dead rocket scientists, we're going to call it the harrowing and possibly irresponsibly provocative opening. Okay, so you were forewarned. Jim and Keith were senior scientists at ATK Systems in northern Utah, where they helped design a key booster for the next space shuttle. Keith was 50, Jim was 38. Both were family men, and they were commuting to work on September 22, 2006, outside Logan, Utah, which is the northernmost county in the state. Verdant, beautiful. Also driving to work that morning was Reggie Shaw. He was age 20, soft-spoken, deferential, very nice guy. I would tell you that you probably wouldn't mind having Reggie Shaw as your son. He was honest to a fault. He attended a Mormon college where he played basketball, and to underscore his honesty, he'd gone on a Mormon mission, and 2 weeks into the mission, he felt duty-bound to admit that he'd had premarital sex in the few months before, and so he was sent home from the mission. Not long after he'd been sent home, on this morning I mentioned, September 22, 2006, Reggie was driving to work to a painting job in his Chevrolet Tahoe, a big SUV. It was drizzling and just after 7 a.m. and he crossed the yellow divider. And he clipped the Saturn carrying rocket scientists Jim and Keith, and they spun across the road and they were hit by a pickup truck carrying 2 tons of horseshoes and horseshoe-making equipment. And they died on impact, and forgive this image, but I on some levels it is relevant because I know you just ate, but the impact was so intense that it popped out both of Keith's eyeballs. Now, in the aftermath, Reggie couldn't remember what had distracted him. He was unhurt but traumatized, but in the months-long investigation that followed, phone records showed exactly what had distracted him. He had texted 11 times in the minutes and seconds before the wreck with his girlfriend, Brianna. And as the evidence unfolded, now Reggie was well into his second Mormon mission. And this time he was called into the director's office again and told he was being sent home. And this time he was told he was being charged with negligent homicide. Long story short, he took a plea deal. He got 30 days in jail. The judge asked him to read Les Miserables so he could learn, like the main character of the book, Jean Valjean, How to Give Back to Society. And some years later, I asked Reggie what could have possibly compelled him to multitask while driving in the rain. "I don't know," he told me. He was mystified. It defied common sense. He was a terribly nice kid, completely caught off guard by his own horrific actions. No one ever told me not to do it. End of story, right? You've heard it before. Open and shut case of DWT, driving while texting or talking. Heartbreaking, maybe reminds us to be careful behind the wheel, but doesn't really have to do with us in our daily lives, right? Well, not so fast. The story was the beginning for me of a journalistic journey. It was a journey that led me to think about what causes us to be so attached to our devices that we'd actually multitask at high speeds, that people en masse would text behind the wheel. As I mentioned, and Jerry mentioned, thank you, we won the Pulitzer for our series on that, which was gratifying to be sure, but it left on the table for me a question. What is it about our devices that is causing us to occasionally leave behind our common sense? Is it doing something not just to our behavior, but our brains? I wondered if it was time to take this story out of the car, and I was prompted in particular by one bit of science. What the researchers told me about what compels us to use our devices, even at times it would seem to defy common sense, is that in two respects they have an addictive property. One respect is physiological, and one is psychological. The physiological aspect of its addictive property is, they said, there is growing but sufficient research to suggest that when you get the ping of your device, when you open it up, when you hear the phone, you get a dopamine squirt. You get a burst in the pleasure centers of your brain. And I bet all of you can sympathize with this. You hear that sound, you get a little, what could that be? You feel compelled to check. Now, what happens over time, the researchers told me, is you get a little more burst, you get a little more burst. Suddenly, in its absence, you feel bored. You seek it out further. That is a kind of physiological addiction. I'm guessing many of you can relate. I'm guessing many of you can relate to what they also described as a psychological component of addiction. Now, forgive me, you are all human, but I will illustrate this by way of a rat example. You are also scientists, so you know the connection. Imagine a rat in a cage with a pellet dispenser, and the rat doesn't know when the food's going to come out, and so the rat feels compelled to check all the time. This is called intermittent reinforcement, and many of you know as scientists that this is one of the most powerful lures in psychology. Just for a second, indulge me by thinking about your BlackBerry or Droid or iPhone as a pellet dispenser. You never know when the good message is going to come. There are hundreds coming in. Which one is going to be the good one? And so you feel compelled to check all the time. So combining these two lures got me thinking about what was happening outside the car. And I just want to say, with regard to Reggie Shaw, the driver in Utah, there were lots of reasons why he may have been texting at that moment. I certainly don't want to reduce it to this one. And we elucidated many of these other pressures, social, governmental, and other, in that series. I won't belabor them here. But what I want to do today is I want to tell you why what happened to Reggie, as distant and tragic as it sounds, isn't all that far removed from what might be happening to the rest of us when we multitask, not in our cars, but in our cubicles, when we check our sports scores during a dinner conversation. You know who you are, Dad. Turn our heads away from our kids to check email. So I'm going to try to tie Reggie Shaw to you, and I'd say, how's that for an ambitious agenda? And I will match Martha Stewart for her audacity. So first, let me tell you how I'm going to break this down. I already gave you chapter one, the harrowing and possibly irresponsible opening. The second I'll call the story of the crazy guy who's nothing like you except that he is. The third chapter is the extremely mediocre but modestly clever mnemonic device. Then simply the startling science. And finally, predictably, and I'm open to other chapter headings here, the big finish. Okay, so part two, the crazy guy who's nothing like you except that he is. Let me pause while I get a quick drink. So I mentioned that this launched for me a journalistic journey to get outside of the car. And this journey had two fundamental components. What were the behaviors that we are exhibiting with our devices? And what does the science say about those behaviors? And I began to investigate those on parallel paths. And let me just start with telling you about the behaviors. I started by just talking to people, lots and lots of people. Lots of everyday folks. I talked to the guy at the park where my kids play, this father who told me he was constantly wired to his devices to the extent that one time he was tinkering with his device and he saw his son, he missed his son, wander off the path in front of him. I heard that story. I heard the story about the graduate students in New York City, the woman and her boyfriend, live-in boyfriend, who sit opposite one another on their computers each night and work and play and don't speak but text to one another as a form of communication. I actually even went to an Alcoholic Anonymous meeting because I was curious about this idea that technology had addictive properties. And afterwards, I talked to a guy, a 20-something, in the parking lot, and I asked him to tell me about his device use versus his addiction to booze. Could he compare them? He said to me, "I check Facebook 600 times a day. I don't even care what people are saying," he told me as he stood in the parking lot. His Yankee cap was pulled down tight, which is strange because we were in San Francisco, but you Yankee fans are insidious and everywhere, and not the point of the address. He said, "I decided not to do Twitter because I couldn't stop. It would make me crazy." He concluded, "These two addictions feel the same to me. Quote, it's not that different from drugs." Well, I heard lots of stories like these that felt to me like outliers, not consistent with a more common experience, and other stories that didn't seem like they'd be particularly interesting to readers. But I also began to cement in my mind a very obvious point, one Jerry alluded to, that as I was trying to understand how technology might be affecting us, I needed to squarely acknowledge that for whatever effects it might have on our focus, whatever addictive properties it might have, whatever it might do to learning and memory, and you will learn that it does have those impacts, it has an extraordinary benefit to us. It is a veritable lifeblood in the 21st century. And so whatever stories I told had to be cognizant and recognize the fact that technology is far from some evil, and this is not some experiment in Luddite journalism. It needed to balance the great benefits. And so then, after months of talking to lots and lots of people, I met Cord Campbell. Cord Campbell was our first story in this series, and he's a fascinating individual that balances both the attributes and some of the deleterious effects I'm talking about. He's an entrepreneur in Northern California, tech savvy, a coder, a native Oklahoman, tall and friendly, a family man with a wife, Brenda, their 16-year-old son, Connor, and an 8-year-old daughter, Lily. And technology has helped Cord and his family build a comfortable lifestyle, fueled his entrepreneurial ambitions, and sometimes led to some very curious problems. Years ago, when he was still in Oklahoma before he moved to the Bay Area, he built a business that helped search engines refine their technology. And the whole idea behind it, his pipe dream, as we all have pipe dreams, was to sell it to a major search engine. That was the star on the horizon. All the while he was building, this is what his work environment looked like. He had two monitors on his desk. The one on the left got email, and he did a lot of IRC, and he got instant messages. The one on the right, he did his coding, and he often read stories on the web and chased down ideas that struck him. And one day, he got an email. It was the email he had been pining for. It was from a major public search company that wanted to buy his startup in a deal worth $1.3 million. And Cord Campbell didn't see it. He didn't see it for a day, and he didn't see it for 2 days, and he didn't see it for a week, and he didn't see it for 2 weeks. And then one day, when he was going through email, old email, he saw it. And the reason he hadn't seen it was because he was so deluged with data and his attention so fractured that the one email he'd been pining for slipped by him. As he described the moment to me when he saw it, he stood up from his desk and he said, and I wish you could meet Cord Campbell. He's this big, posing, generally soft-spoken guy. He stood up and he said, "Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God." He sent a prompt note, an apologetic one, to the search company making the offer, and he managed to salvage the deal. But for Cord and for his family, it was a key bit of evidence indicating that something was amiss in the way he was balancing technology in his life, and it was far from isolated. Little other things. His attachment to his devices, which he goes to bed with on his chest at night and wakes up with in the morning, has caused him to burn a hamburger on the grill. Forget to pick up his kids from school occasionally. He once missed an airline flight. His son Connor has started to get his first C's. Well, maybe no surprise when you see his work environment. His Facebook updates come at him on the same computer that he does his studying on. He plays video games between classes at his high school on his phone. His daughter Lily says, "I think Daddy likes technology more than he likes me." His wife Brenda, who is the consummate homemaker, one time was making cookies for a school event, and her text went off in the other room, and she went to get it. She burned the cookies. She got so engaged in her text. She went back, put in another batch of cookies. Text went off. She burned the second batch. She told me it was one of the most mortifying times in my life. I had to bring store-bought cookies to the school. So yes, these might sound like relatively extreme stories, at least on the face, but they're not when you start to hear the science. And I'm going to come to it in a moment, but first I want to give you the extremely mediocre mnemonic device, but at least it's mildly clever. Here's your mnemonic device for remembering what heavy technology use and multitasking might be doing to your brain. Let me get a quick drink. Your mnemonic device is iPhone. Okay. I, inhibited sleep and increased restlessness. P, performance loss or performance costs. H, I warned you ahead of time this was mediocre. Hippocampus needs rest. I'll explain it in a moment. O, overriding of learning and memory. N, again, you were forewarned. Nora Volkov, that's what your N stands for. She's the head of the National Institute for Drug Abuse. And E for iPhone, exceptionally helpful, meaning your devices. So please take what I say with a grain of salt. iPhone, chapter 3, I'll come back to it later. Here's your next chapter, the startling science behind the mediocre mnemonic. While I was meeting with the Campbells, I was also interviewing on a parallel track. And this was about the science behind the behavior, and this is how I came to meet Eyal Ofer. Eyal Ofer is a researcher at Stanford, and he'd come to Stanford after doing a stint in the Israeli intelligence. He'd come to the Israeli intelligence after a stint in the Israeli Air Force, from which he had been booted. And he was frustrated, and he thought he knew why he had been booted out. He thought he'd been booted out because he couldn't multitask. He said, pilots are people who are tremendous at switching tasks. And when he got to Stanford, he stumbled onto some very early research in the psychology and communications department about the behavior of multitaskers. And Eyal, very bright guy, was asked to join the team, and he thought, aha, I'm going to figure out how to be a better multitasker. I'm a guy who tends to focus on one thing at a time. I'll get to the bottom of this. So he and some very hotshot researchers began testing the performance of multitaskers in a series of tests they ran in a small windowless room in the basement of the communications department. And on its face, these would seem very boring to you. You were trying to switch tasks and juggle tasks like moving back and forth between focusing on capital letters and small letters and colors and shapes and numbers. But they're tried and true, and among, as the research will know, researchers will know in this room, oftentimes you have to have basic fundamental ways for testing human behavior that are measurable. In a variety of these tasks, what they discovered was self-described heavy multitaskers, heavy media multitaskers, tended to do much worse on a variety of tasks than people who were heavy single taskers. The multimedia taskers were less good at filtering relevant from irrelevant information. Remarkably, they were less good at switching among tasks. The multitaskers were less good at multitasking, if you will. They were less good at doing creative tasks when left alone to do them over a short period of time. So, essentially, as I say, they were less good at multitasking. And while the researchers were surprised by this, there was one bit of very historic research that will come as little surprise to you that reinforced this idea. And that was the idea that the brain, rather than actually multitasking, and you might know this, it tends to be a myth, does one task at a time. The brain rapidly switches between tasks. It doesn't dual process. And IL and the researchers gave me a simple test you can do yourself to prove this. They called it the cocktail conversation test. You can do this this afternoon. You're in a cocktail party and you're focused on the person in front of you. Try to listen to the conversation happening between or among the people behind you. You can't do it. You have to switch among them. Or watch TV and try to read a book. It can't be done. You have to switch. But Ayal and his researchers thought, well, maybe in this multitasking era, we're getting better. Could we actually be getting worse? And what they were left with was a question about whether this was causation or correlation. Were multitaskers people who were so drawn to fractured attention that that's why they were doing worse at these tasks? Or was something about the way we're using our devices, or put more pointedly, is there something about the way our devices are affecting us actually causing us to be less effective and more fractured? Ayal had his own theory that was born out of what happened to him when he got an iPhone. Prior to that, this self-professed single tasker would sit on the floor with his toddler and be in the moment. He said, as soon as I got an iPhone, something very strange happened. I would feel its ping even when it wasn't going off and even when it wasn't in my pocket. I felt it calling to me from the other room. What's happening to me? So that led me to start to ask the question, is this causation or is it correlation? So I want to tell you before I answer that as a predicate a little bit about how the brain works. Again, you may know this, some of you, but worth revisiting. The last part of the brain to develop is the frontal cortex. It's our control tower. It's the part researchers say make us the most human. It helps us decide what our priorities are. And in a way, it's always under assault from other parts of the brain, especially the sensory parts of our brain. You see something, you hear something, and the message gets sent to the frontal lobe that says, should I reorient my priorities? And I'll give you an example from millennia ago to underscore this. One of our forebears, loincloth, building a hut, sees a lion. Sensory cortex says to frontal cortex, what should I do? Frontal cortex says, run. Priorities are reoriented. Well, lots of neuroscientists describe to me a modern version of this dynamic when our device goes off. Ping on our phone sends a message to the prefrontal cortex. Should I reorient my priorities? Well, guess what? it's happening a lot, a lot, a lot. In fact, neuroscientists described to me what they called a kind of a mini civil war, let's say it small c, small w, of pinging, constantly coming to your prefrontal cortex saying, reorient, reorient, focus on my kids, focus on the project on my computer, or answer my device, answer an instant message. Here's how much information's coming at us. University of researchers at San Diego say three times more media are coming at us today than in the 1960s. And the nature of that media has vastly changed. It was TV and radio. Now it's interactive. Here's a stat that blew me away when we did our first story about Cord Campbell. A company that puts software on your computer to test how you use your time found that the average cubicle worker changes to email or other programs 37 times an hour. That's how, I actually got an open mouth there. Someone is listening. So, you will get a cash reward. Oh, she's also reading. It turns out her mouth was open due to an email she received. However, her mouth being open sent a note to my prefrontal cortex that said reorient speech. Adam Ghazali, a neuroscientist at the University of California at San Francisco, told me, in light of all this information, he said, we're exposing our brains to an environment and asking them to do things we weren't necessarily evolved to do. And he said, we already know there are consequences. And he gave me one little neat little analogy. He said, the only time he could think about in human history when we were asked to digest more kinds of new information was when we started to move into villages and saw lots of faces. And we found, think of faces as data. That's the only analogy he could find in human history to compare to how much information our brains are digesting today. So now he and other neuroscientists have begun to show the impact. And I'm going to tell you, I've tried to save this for later because it's hard to jump immediately into science. But I just want to tell you a bit of the fascinating research that I've stumbled into. So a really key part of our neurological infrastructure is our working memory. This is a part of our memory, a part of our brains that we call upon in an immediate moment when we're in a conversation or I'm giving this speech or you're in an intimate conversation. It's this little suitcase of salient information. And researchers have known for years that it tends to contain technically 7 plus or minus 2 pieces of information. So either 5 or 9 pieces of information at any given time. As you might imagine, when you're multitasking, that takes up some of that information and detracts from your ability to focus. But here's the remarkable bit of science. The mere anticipation of something takes up your working memory. So if you have a device that you anticipate checking or that you have reason to believe will send you information because you're habituated to checking it, you're taking up one of those 7 bits of salient, important information you need to conduct business. There's one bit of research. Then there's a study in rats. Back to the rats. Fascinating research into the brain of rats done at University of San Francisco, California at San Francisco. They put EEG monitors on rats, and they watched what happened when a rat went into a new environment. Let's say walked onto a table it had never been onto before. And new activity was created in the hippocampus. Remember that word I mentioned earlier? It's considered the gateway to memory. Well, when the rat later took a nap or had downtime, that very neurological activity spread out into the rest of the brain. It effectively became ensconced as memory and learning. But if the rat did not have downtime, the neurological activity effectively died. That new experience was not encoded. Another imaging study, this one in humans, to reinforce what I'll tell you is the conclusion of that. Remember how they used to put, or you know, not they didn't used to, they still do, MRI machines, if you've ever been in one, they look at what's happening inside your body or your brain. In some ways, very primitive. They would look at, they'd put someone in an MRI machine and they'd ask them to sing. And they'd look at which part of their brain lit up. Or they'd ask them to squeeze a ball and watch their motor cortex. Well, there was a bit of a mysterious, a kind of a mystery accident, a moment that was unexpected by scientists. They were asking the subjects not to do anything between tasks. And entire parts of the brain lit up during the downtime. Parts of the brain called the default network that is understood to be involved when you synthesize information, when you are creative, when you develop your idea of self versus other people. So what the researchers said these things lead them to believe is the huge benefit of downtime. The researchers told me that it's not a big extrapolation to think that all those little moments that we used to have downtime, that we now are multitasking, in line at the grocery store, checking your device. Again, you know who you are, in the bathroom. That these little moments are stealing from us downtime that can have real benefits. Now, in any given moment, that's not a problem, but if you begin to add up all the time that you are not having downtime, here's what Michael Rich, a physician who heads the Department of Media and Child Health at Harvard, said to me. The headline is, bring back boredom. Downtime is for the brain what sleep is for the body. Now, I'm going to come back to him in a minute, but let me add one more study to underscore this idea that rest for the brain is being compromised right now and that it has an impact. At the University of Michigan, they took a group of people and a control group, and they asked them, one group to walk in nature and the other group to walk in a dense urban environment. And then they asked them to learn something. Or perhaps they asked them to learn before their walk. Regardless, the group in the nature had a 30% better learning performance than the group that walked in the dense urban environment. Now you might ask, what does that have to do with computers? But what the inference from the researchers was that when you take in information, even passively, in a dense urban environment, it fatigues the parts of your brain involved in learning and memory. If you multiply that by the active investment that we make in our devices all the time, then you can see where our memory our memory and learning can get impinged by lack of downtime. Finally, one more study, and this is the last that I'll cite on these, but it's really quite interesting. Comes from the Sports University of Cologne. They took 12 to 14 year old boys, and they asked them to play video games each night for an hour after they did their homework. And then in other cases, they asked them to watch a movie like Harry Potter after they did their homework. What they discovered is the kids who played video games not only had worse sleep patterns, they also did far worse by a statistically significant degree at remembering their vocabulary the next day. Now, the researcher who led this, having moved from Germany to become a Harvard fellow, said, I can't tell you if the reason that they're performing less well is because they lost some sleep, or, as I speculate, because the intensity of interactive experience is so powerful that it's overriding their learning experience. Well, what's the sum of this? N in iPhone, Nora Volkov, the head of the National Institute for Drug Abuse, and one of the preeminent scientists in the world, told me that she thinks of the heavy impact of technology use, particularly compulsive multitasking, as working many of the same mechanisms in the brain as addiction. People feel they can't stop, they're agitated when they disconnect, they lose productivity and continue to use their devices even when it impinges what they otherwise say they need to do. To quote Nora Volkov, heavy technology use is, quote, rewiring our brains. And another word from Michael Rich, the gentleman from Harvard I mentioned earlier. I got on the phone with him to do this last story about high schoolers, and I said, come on, Michael, can you prove to me that heavy technology use is rewiring the minds of our kids? And he says, can I prove it to you? He said, can I prove to you that smoking causes cancer? Not the way you mean it. Nor can I prove to you that smoking causes cancer. But as researchers, we make inferences from a lot of reasonable information. And I have concluded from the science that is out there that I'm prepared to tell parents and for parents to tell their kids, you should start to disconnect and be a lot more judicious about your time online because it is affecting your brain. So I'm going to sum up. I want to just quickly go back to our mnemonic to tie it together. iPhone, eye inhibited sleep and increased restlessness or agitation when you disconnect. Performance loss, hippocampus needs rest. H, O, overriding learning and memory. N, you now know Nora Volkov. E, exceptionally helpful, meaning our devices. So take what I say with a grain of salt. I'm going to tie this back to you and Reggie Shaw. But first, one more thing about this E, exceptionally helpful, meaning our devices. Look, this last chapter could also be called, Matt, who you kidding? I mean, I can Skype with my wife and two little kids. I wrote this speech on a word processor. It also had spell check, so I can read what I wrote. You cannot understate the value of technology in our lives, and I don't want to, which is why over the course of doing this series, I found an analogy that I think is very apt, and I'll tell you by way of summing up. I think now of technology as food. Food is essential for life. Thank you, New York Times, for this startling insight. Technology is essential for life, but like some food is not as good for us as others, and like some food leads to obesity, so overconsumption of technology is not good for us. And think of some technology as Brussels sprouts and some as Twinkies. Now, you may see on its face what this has to do with Cord Campbell and maybe some of your own habits, but just to put a fine point on it, when Cord wasn't using, he felt the lure of his devices. It hurt his performance and so on and so forth. What does any of this have to do with Reggie Shaw and two dead rocket scientists and any connection I'd provocatively imply? Well, look, at his baseline, Reggie Shaw was a good person. He had generally common sense, although he was young. He suffered great guilt when he told the Utah State Legislature that he was the one who killed those two dead rocket scientists. He wept and brought the house down. You might say, and he took full responsibility, and he'd hate to hear me say what I'm about to say, but you might say that to an extent his brain was hijacked, that he couldn't help himself. He was caught up in a neurological and sociological and psychological phenomenon. On the whole, this has nothing to do with you, but I'd simply leave you with this question. Reggie Shaw had his blind spots. What are your blind spots? What are the places where your proverbial kid is walking off the path where you're not paying attention, where your performance is suffering because you can't help multitask, where it's hurting the intimacy of your relationships? I want to leave this on an up note, and I will in 1 second, but just one harrowing little tragedy that happened last week in Los Angeles at the Staples Center at a Lakers game. Two parents had taken digital photos of their two-year-old toddler, and they were admiring them. And the toddler slipped over the balcony, fell 50 feet, and died. And they were looking at his picture on their digital camera. So I think blind spots abound to some extent in this world. I'm going to end here. I've overstayed my welcome. I apologize for going a little bit long. I want to thank you for listening. I'll leave you with an apology. Given that you made me feel like Martha Stewart for a day, I probably should have brought dessert or shaved a castle from ice. I will do so next time. I know we're coming to the end. If I can answer any questions, thank you very much for your time.
Hi, I can really identify with that dopamine hit. I really can. But occasionally, when I've been able to really focus and come out of that period of focus, of being in the zone, I also psychologically feel really good. Do you have any advice about how to train that and increase the dopamine hit we get from being able to focus?
You know, I actually will tell you an interesting thing that we're about to write about that the Army is doing. The Army, is anybody here from the Wall Street Journal? Otherwise, I'm not prepared to talk about this. They are all tweeting, therefore not paying attention, therefore I'm solid. The Army suffers information overload in an enormous respect, and they have handheld devices in the field. They're getting more information than ever. And a lot of it's incredibly valuable tactical information. What target should we hit? What should we avoid? How do we avoid a trap? At the very time, a lot of the soldiers coming in are of Generation Y and accustomed to constantly switching tasks. And so they're having to figure out, how do we train a generation of people who have trouble focusing when we have more information than ever that we need for tactical reasons? They are using the oldest technology in the book in a pilot project in Hawaii. They are asking the soldiers to meditate. And they are finding that their capacity to focus and the calm and enjoyment they get from that experience expands in that. Now, I don't know if you're doing military work, so it's probably not applicable. No, I'm just kidding. But that might be, I don't know if that answers, but it might be worth a shot. It's something I use because it prolongs those periods that I don't need the dopamine squirt that I also can crave.
It's a more a personal question, and that is, all these articles and this being immersed in these discussions, how did it change your life? And did it?
Yeah, it's changed it in one really fundamental fashion, and it's been a very hard change. I mentioned that I have two little kids. I have a 2-year-old son and a 3-month-old daughter. Lots of research I didn't mention today, but some fascinating stuff by the guy who did the seminal work on television about what happens to your parental involvement when there's a screen in the room. And your parenting goes down measurably. And they've done phenomenal, fascinating, frightening research on that. We removed the television from the upstairs of our house to do what we thought was mitigating that problem. But we also have 2 laptops, and I can't even guess how many phones. And those things beckoned us all the time. And I find that I have the capacity to rationalize my need to look at those devices for reasons that are not truly urgent. And I am trying to learn to redefine what urgency means so that I'm not complicating my relationship with my kids. The researchers would say that what the kids pick up is, I'm half paying attention to you. If half and two-thirds can go together, I'm two-thirds paying attention to my device. So I'm trying to be better about that. Yes.
Yeah. Nick Bilton, also from the New York Times,
yes,
has recently written a book that presents almost an opposite,
yes,
view on the topic, and quoting the same neuroscience research. And I was wondering if you guys talk to each other, and if so, what comes out of that?
I talk to Nick all the time. It's so odd. When I talk to him, it sounds to me like he's agreeing with me. Nick was actually in on a lot of the meetings. Nick is a blogger for the Times, who blogs about tech issues. And he brings a very... and he's a little younger, and he brings a view that says technology is really a positive influence. As I say, I don't disagree, but he was interpreting information in a way that I didn't necessarily agree with, but that we folded in very much into our coverage to balance out some of the things you're saying. So far from dismissing it, we were aware of it and folded it into our coverage. I think if you read his closely, you'll see that there's a lot more consistencies than you might imagine in what we're doing. Yes.
It really sounds like the whole point is moderation. I mean, anything, too much of anything, just about anything, isn't good for you. So, I mean, I could see where you would be consistent in that.
I think that's very true. And the reason, it might sound obvious to say moderation, but look where we've come from in the last 15 years. For a long period, we celebrated all technology as progress. And it has only been in the last couple of years that we have asked a question, well, is all technology equal? I think that's what a new generation of journalism is beginning to ask. It is foolish and arrogant to the point of someone should probably physically attack me to say that this has anything to do with Upton Sinclair and the jungle. But I do think that just as when we processed food, we began to ask questions about what part's good, what part's bad. There's no doubt we need more food, and manufacturing, unless you only read Michael Pollan, is very good. I think it's fair to ask, what are some of the unintended consequences of this? And I think that our journalism, not to sound too defensive, coupled with a little, you mentioned Nicholas Carr, is the seminal journalism beginning to ask that question. I think it's going to go further in the future. I'll just tell you, I'll pause here. I have one other observation, but let me see if there's more questions.
Thanks. This is Rhonda Oliver of Royal College of Nursing. I just wondered if Mrs. Cord Campbell's experience with her cookies is the exception that proves the rule that women are much better at multitasking than men, and whether there are, in fact, any gender differences that emerge from your studies.
This is fraught with danger. I will say this. I am a better baker than my wife.
I'll text you.
Are you trying to have me killed? There are extradition rules with the United States.
I think you might have been going where this question is going, but correct me. The devices that we have today are nowhere near as intrusive as the devices we're going to have in the future. So can I get your take on that?
Yeah, I mean, that is absolutely the case, and I'll tell you two anecdotes to underscore it. One, I had an iPhone, which is a pretty intrusive, a very valuable device, but a pretty intrusive device. And because if you're not from America, this won't make sense. But that's carried by something called AT&T, which is also something called a network that doesn't work, and so I switched to an Android phone, and it was only 6 months after, or a year after, I had the iPhone, and it came loaded with so many more apps that beckoned for my attention so much more, and that was in a mere 18-month period. Now, but another way to do this is historically. Jerry mentioned this last story that we did on, we did it about a high school. I think arguably it's the most powerful story that we did in this series, and it speaks even more pointedly about this issue because it asks, what is heavy technology use doing to the developing brains of kids? And there is a peculiarity to it that separates them from adults. But the researchers said that we were asked, well, kids before had television, what's so different? And the researchers said, look, you couldn't take your TV, sneak it under your covers, your 30-inch CRT, and if you could do that to watch Gilligan's Island, you couldn't talk to it. And if you could talk to Marianne, and I probably tried, she couldn't talk back. And if she could, you weren't having five simultaneous conversations. And you can see the trajectory of technology over time becoming much more not necessarily intrusive, but ubiquitous and interactive and intense.
David Thomas with Thomson Reuters. Are we setting ourselves up for a whole new form of addiction, that there's going to have to be treatments, there's going to have to be education, there's going to have to be the same things we do with cigarettes and with drugs and everything? I mean, that's my sense of where it's headed, especially with the generation coming up now, because they're so comfortable and embedded with it. When you see young people walking down the street, they're all doing this, not talking to each other. They're all looking at their devices, and that's how people get killed walking across the street.
Well, I'll take my New York Times hat off for a second, because I think it's not fair for me to say this and that in this respect, but my answer without it on is, yeah, I think so. And I can give you concrete evidence. In Korea, they're already treating kids for video game addiction. But when I did this Woodside High School story, there was a young woman who sends and receives 27,000 texts a month. And she is not that anomalous. Now, one thing about addiction, and you probably know this, is not everyone's susceptible. I mean, lots of us drink alcohol, and I think it's like 15% of people have the addiction gene or whatever it is, and same less for marijuana and so on and so forth. But there are going to be some groups of people who cannot stop using their devices to the point where it qualifies by the definitions of addiction. And I mentioned the young fella I met at AA, and he would squarely tell you, these are the same mechanisms for me. So, I also happen to know some addicts, and I've lost at least one good friend to alcohol addiction. And I can see similarities among people who have alcohol and gambling addictions. And so this might fall into that category for some. But I want to be careful that that's not repertorial wisdom. That's now I'm just a jerk off. So.
I basically agree with you, but I usually argue with my son, who grew up working, doing homework, watching TV, and listening to iPod, and I cannot convince him of this argument. Since you mentioned the Israeli Air Force, one of the arguments that we have is that Air Force, especially fighter pilots who fly at Mach 2, how are they able to switch attention while flying at that high speed? And they had to switch attention in a fraction of a second. And if they are capable of doing it, they are human beings. Why can other people do it?
So I'll tell you a few things. One, at the University of Utah, they've begun to image the brains of Air Force pilots to see if they can see anything in there that might let them know that. But before you jump to the conclusion they can do more than the rest of us, you should also know there have been some horrific accidents involving pilots. And the pilots themselves refer to their screens that are awash in information as drool buckets. And they call them that because they can get so lost staring at them that they say, well, we're drooling just like kids who get stuck staring at a video game screen. And the Air Force is cognizant of this, is trying to figure out what can we do to change how we prioritize the focus in a cockpit, because they are quite worried that the brains are not capable of keeping up with that information. So the premise of your question is one I think I'd have to know more about. I can just say that it does seem that some people can do better than others, but I'm not sure. I think everybody has some real costs involved with task switching, and that systems need to be built around the understanding that there are limitations inside our brains. Yes?
Hi, David Smith from Cabby. In listening to your talk, and I have to confess, tweeting through it as well, sorry. I was thinking about some of the...
Did you mention my tie? Because I think it's very...
No, I didn't mention your tie. I'm sorry.
Very selfish.
Or your baking. Sorry, what was my question? My question was, I was thinking about some of the websites that are coming out now that are putting gaming mechanics explicitly into their persuasion strategies to keep people involved. Things like Foursquare with the badges and the location services. And I don't know, a little connection went off there, and I was thinking, surely they're trying to do a persuasion approach that's cooking in ongoing, continuous distraction. And I don't know whether you had any comment on that.
I think it's a really wonderful observation. Again, if you're from the Wall Street Journal, earmuff it, or if you're dating or married to someone, don't pass it along. But we're thinking about a story that has to do with the use of games now to entreat people to stay. And you're right about why that is. And I actually think this is very interesting for your industry. We have mourned inside The Times, the loss, obviously, of our print, the advertising revenue, and how much harder it is to build equivalent revenue online. But there is a dirty little secret that, it's not even a secret, it's an observation that I've had that no one would bother to talk about in the boardroom because these are among the many floors of the New York Times I'm not allowed onto. But, you know, something, for as much revenue as we lose at the New York Times because we used to charge $50,000 a page or whatever it was, and now we charge banner ad rates, as we become more interactive and stickier on our site, we are keeping people around that much longer. And I don't think we're fully aware of how much, when people come to us online, we have the capacity to get them to stay there through lots of little tricks, like games, like popping up, did you see this article? I mean, we are playing, I don't think we'd ever say this because the research isn't necessarily there to back it up and it would be irresponsible, but just from where I sit on this reporting, we are to an extent playing to people's neurology with that. We're giving them a little dopamine squirt. So, yes.
Jane Marks from Sage. My comment actually feeds into that very nicely. There are publishers now using gaming technology to develop teaching tools for kids. So do you think we're now playing to that, or is it actually going to damage their learning ability in the long run?
I mean, that is an amazingly good question, and I haven't looked into it, and I'm even though you've seen me go off the cuff a little bit and answer some things that I'm not entirely sure about, that's what I'm really nervous about discussing because I think it is such an operative question, and we don't yet know completely what online tools and games are teaching and which ones are distraction. There are some sites that are very well regarded that profess to tell you which games online have real central education value. If you happen to go back and look at the last story, this one we've mentioned about Woodside High School, I did a short sidebar about what experts recommend you do for your kids. One of them, who's mentioned in it, if you just read it, it's 350 words, talks about, I think, the kinds of sites you may be able to go to see what learning tools are good. But the way he summed it up for me is, if you're looking to help out your kids, try to get them away from the 90% of time they spend online that is entertainment, and get them to sites that are education-centric. If you do that alone, you've made a good first step. Yes.
Tim Murray from Cambridge University Press. In your article, do you actually link to all the research?
We do. In the last one, we do. I sense that that question is pregnant with something else, and I'm wondering what it is. Yeah, I mean, look, that's something we've begun to do, and it's, as you know, some we can link to, and some it's not so easy to, but we can link to abstracts. In the last article, it was very valuable. Someone wrote back to me and said, I read this study, and I thought it was really interesting that it said this, this, and this. In a previous one, we failed to link to the research, and I got ad nauseum notes saying, where do I find it? We're trying to be better, and we can be better.
I have one final question. Is there a book in this?
Yeah, there. I've talked to my generally the books that I've been doing have been fiction that actually are connected to this, and one of them's coming out in May. But we've been talking about whether there's a book that has to do with. I would think maybe would take some families in a school and try to marry not just the kids' experience, but the social pressures they get from their parents and the parental experience, and tried to define a moment in time when we're not only trying to strike a balance, but we're beginning to see the behavioral and neurologic effects. Immodestly, we've had some very nice offers from publishers, but so far we haven't had the right marriage. As you guys know, books are hard to do, and I'm only going to do it under the right circumstances. But even though there's been some stuff out there, I think there's a lot more to say because the science is just unfolding every day. And people seem, this series, they tell me, was the most viewed series of any done in the New York Times this year, which suggests to me that audiences are very eager to learn more. So I thank you so much for, you've been very gracious. It looks like people... at least a quarter of the people were actually focused on what I was saying, which is two-thirds greater than what my research suggested was possible. Thank you. Thank you to you guys. Thank you.